All right, everyone, welcome to our deep dive into the world of APIs. You know, it's funny, APIs are everywhere in our digital lives, but most of us probably don't even realize they're there. It's kind of like the electricity that powers our homes. We use it every day, it's essential, but we rarely stop to think about how it actually works. So to help us demystify APIs, we're joined by an expert in the field. So maybe we can start with the basics. What exactly is an API?
Well, an API, or Application Programming Interface, is essentially a set of rules and specifications that allow different software systems to communicate with each other. Think of it like a waiter in a restaurant. You, the diner, are the client, the kitchen is the server, and the API is the waiter.
Okay, I think I'm following. So I, the client, place my order, the waiter, the API, takes that order to the kitchen, the server, and then brings me back my food. Is that right?
Exactly. The API acts as an intermediary facilitating communication between the client and the server. Now, in the digital world, this food is data.
So when I use my banking app to check my balance, the app is the client, my bank's server is the server, and the API is what allows them to exchange information about my account.
Precisely. The API sends your request to the bank's server, retrieves the data, and delivers it back to your app, all in a secure and standardized way.
So APIs are essentially the messengers of the digital world, carrying requests and delivering data between different applications.
That's a great way to put it.
Now, I know there are different types of APIs out there.
Right, there are.
Could you walk us through some of the main ones?
Sure. One common type is web APIs. These are APIs that are accessed over the internet using the HTTP protocol.
So things like checking the weather on my phone or posting on social media, those are all using web APIs.
Exactly. Web APIs are incredibly versatile, and they're used in countless applications and services.
Okay, so that's web APIs. What about other types?
Well, another one you might have heard of is SOAP, which stands for Simple Object Access Protocol. SOAPs is an older type of API, but it's still used in some enterprise settings.
SOAP, I've heard that one before, but I don't really know much about it.
SOAP APIs use XML for data formatting, and they can be quite complex to work with. They're often described as being heavyweight.
Heavyweight, meaning?
Meaning they require a lot of overhead in terms of data transfer and processing.
Ah, okay. So maybe not the most efficient option in all cases.
That's right. But SOAP does have its advantages, particularly in situations where security and reliability are paramount.
Gotcha. So web APIs and SOAP, are there any other big ones we should know about?
Yes, there's also RPC, which stands for Remote Procedure Call.
RPC, what's that all about?
RPC is a way for a program to execute code on a remote server.
Interesting.
There are a few different flavors of RPC, such as XML RPC and JSON RPC.
XML RPC and JSON RPC.
Right. As their name suggests, they use XML and JSON respectively for data formatting.
Okay, starting to see a pattern here.
Yes. Data formatting is a key aspect of how APIs work.
So we got a web API, SOAP, and RPC. What about the one everyone seems to be talking about these days? REST.
Yes, REST. REST, or Representational State Transfer, is currently the most popular architectural style for web APIs.
Why is that?
Well, there are a few reasons. REST is designed to be lightweight, flexible, and easy to use.
So kind of the opposite of SOAP, in a way.
You could say that. REST APIs leverage the existing infrastructure of the internet using HTTP for communication, and they can handle various data formats such as JSON and XML.
So REST sounds pretty versatile.
It is. It's also highly scalable, which is why it's become the go-to choice for many large-scale web applications.
Okay, I'm starting to see why REST is such a big deal, but what exactly makes a REST API RESTful?
That's a great question. REST is more than just a set of technologies. It's an architectural style with certain guiding principles.
Principles, huh? Like what?
Well, there are six key constraints that define a RESTful API. Client-server, stateless, cacheable, uniform interface, layered system, and code-on-demand.
Wow, that's a mouthful.
It is, but don't worry. We'll break down each of these constraints in more detail as we go along.
Okay, good. Because I'm definitely intrigued. I'm starting to get a sense of how powerful APIs can be. And REST in particular sounds like it has a lot to offer.
It does. REST has revolutionized the way we build and interact with web applications. And it's a fascinating topic to explore.
Well, I'm definitely eager to learn more. So let's dive into those RESTful principles and see what makes them tick.
Sounds good to me. Welcome back to our deep dive on APIs. Last time we left off talking about those six key constraints that define a RESTful API.
Yeah, the client server, stateless, cacheable, all those.
Exactly. And today we're going to unpack one of the most crucial ones, the uniform interface.
Okay, uniform interface. What's that all about?
Well, in simple terms, it means that a REST API should provide a consistent and predictable way for clients to interact with it.
So no matter what programming language the client is using or what platform they're on, they should be able to interact with the API in the same way.
Precisely. The uniform interface is what makes REST API so easy to use and integrate with.
Okay, that makes sense. But how exactly does REST achieve this uniformity?
Well, it's all about adhering to certain principles. One of the key principles is using unique URIs to identify resources.
URIs, right? Those are like web addresses.
Exactly. Each resource in a REST API should have its own unique URI.
So if we're talking about a banking API, for example, there would be a separate URI for accessing customer information, account details, transaction history, and so on.
Exactly. Each URI represents a specific resource.
Okay, so that's URIs. What else contributes to this uniform interface?
Another important principle is manipulating resources through representations.
Representations?
Yeah, so instead of directly accessing the data on the server, clients work with a representation of that data.
I think I need an example here.
Sure, let's stick with the banking analogy. Imagine you want to retrieve information about a customer's account. Instead of directly accessing the database record, which could be in a format that's difficult for clients to work with, the API would provide you with a representation of that account in a format like JSON or XML.
Ah, so it's like getting a summary report instead of having to dig through the entire filing cabinet.
Exactly. This separation between the actual data and its representation is a key aspect of REST.
I see. So the client never actually interacts with the data directly. It only works with representations.
That's right.
And this benefits REST how?
Well, for one thing, it makes the API more flexible. The server can change how it stores data internally without affecting how clients interact with it.
As long as the representation format stays the same?
Exactly.
Okay, that's clever. So we've got unique URIs for identifying resources and representations for manipulating them.
Right.
Anything else?
Look, another crucial principle is using self-descriptive messages.
Self-descriptive messages.
It means that each message exchanged between the client and the server should contain all the information necessary for understanding and processing it.
So it's like each message comes with its own set of instructions.
Precisely. This makes REST APIs much easier to work with because clients don't need to have any prior knowledge about the API structure or data formats.
They can just read the messages and figure things out.
Exactly.
That's pretty cool.
It is. And it leads to the final principle of the uniform interface, HATEOAS.
HATEOAS. Now that's a mouthful.
It is, but it's not as complicated as it sounds.
Hopefully.
HATEOAS stands for Hypermedia as the Engine of Application State.
Okay, I understand the individual words, but altogether it's still a bit of a mystery.
Basically, HATEOAS means that the API should provide clients with links to related resources within its responses.
So it's like a built-in navigation system for the API.
Exactly. Instead of having to hard-code URIs into their applications, clients can just follow the links provided by the API.
I see. So it's like clicking on a next page link on a website. The server tells you where to go next without you needing to know the exact address.
Precisely. HATEOAS makes REST APIs more discoverable and easier to navigate.
And it reduces the amount of code that clients need to write. Okay, so we've got URIs, representations, self-descriptive messages, and HATEOAS. All these things work together to create this uniform interface that makes the REST API so powerful.
That's right.
It's like a well-designed building. Everything has its place, and it all fits together seamlessly.
I like that analogy.
So understanding REST isn't just about memorizing those six constraints. It's about understanding this underlying philosophy of a uniform interface.
Absolutely. Building a truly RESTful API requires a deep understanding of these principles.
Okay, I'm starting to get the bigger picture here. But I have to admit, all this talk about APIs is making me a bit curious. Like, how are these things actually being used in the real world?
Well, that's a great segue into our next topic, real-world applications of REST APIs.
Perfect, let's dive in. All right, so we've talked a lot about the theory behind REST APIs, but now I'm really curious to see how this all plays out in the real world.
Yeah, let's get practical. I think one of the most relatable examples is online shopping.
Okay, online shopping, sure. I definitely do a lot of that.
Well, every time you browse products, add items to your cart, or make a purchase.
You're interacting with a network of REST APIs. Really?
Oh, yeah. The e-commerce site you're using is likely using APIs to connect to various back-end systems.
Like inventory management, payment processing, shipping logistics, all that stuff.
Exactly. These APIs allow the website to seamlessly retrieve product information, process orders, and track shipments.
So it's all happening behind the scenes without me even realizing it.
Exactly. REST APIs make the entire online shopping experience smooth and efficient.
Wow, that's pretty impressive. What other examples can you think of?
Well, another big one is social media.
Social media, right? I mean, I spend way too much time on those apps.
Well, those apps are powered by a complex web of REST APIs.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Every time you scroll through your feed, like a post or leave a comment,
you're triggering API calls.
These APIs allow the social media platform to retrieve data from its servers, update your feed, and send notifications.
So it's like a constant conversation between my phone and the social media company's servers.
Exactly. And REST APIs are what make that conversation possible.
I see. So REST APIs are pretty much everywhere.
They are. They're the backbone of the modern web.
Okay, I'm convinced. APIs are amazing. And REST is definitely the king of the hill right now.
I agree with that. REST has become the de facto standard for web APIs.
So for all you inspiring developers out there, if you want to build modern web applications, you need to learn REST.
Absolutely. Understanding RESTful principles is essential for anyone working in web development today.
Well, I think we've covered a lot of ground here.
We have.
From the basics of what an API is, to the intricacies of RESTful architecture, we've really gone deep.
We have. But it's all been worth it, I think.
Definitely. I feel like I have a much better understanding of APIs now, and I'm excited to see how they continue to shape the digital world.
Me too. The possibilities are endless.
Well, on that note, I think it's time to wrap up this deep dive.
Sounds good.
Thanks so much for joining us and sharing your expertise.
It was my pleasure.
And to all our listeners out there, we hope you found this episode informative and engaging. Be sure to subscribe to our Topictrick YouTube channel for more deep dives into the world of technology. Until next time, keep exploring and stay curious.